Welcome back to week five, and in video five, we will talk about how we measure air pressure and wings. So some of the tools that we use to measure air pressure are barometers, both liquid and aneroid. Your book has a great description and some great diagrams of how each of these work. It's customarily measured in inches, millimeters, or millibars, and this is because of this kind of early method of using liquid barometer. So if we have a tube of mercury or some kind of liquid that has open on the bottom, the air pressure will push down on the open area and force the tube of mercury up, and then we can measure how high that pressure has been changed or decreased as well. And then aneroid barometers have a similar kind of function, although it is not liquid. It's a coil inside of the instrument. Again, check out your book. It has some great details. So the measurements of the air pressure will actually tell you a little bit of information about where high pressure and low pressure centers are. So in the case of surface maps, these show what the surface air pressure is like and air currents that are like. So it shows where the high and low pressure zones are. So if I enlarge this diagram real quick here, you can see lots of information on here. The black lines are pressure lines. And then here you can see a closed black line with an H in the center. Each of these lines has a number on them. These other features here are called station models. We'll talk about in the next few slides. So we should measure the air pressure at each location, and then we can get an idea of what the pressure is like in an area. We can construct these pressure lines and then find out where the highs and lows are located. We can also determine what the upper air pressures are like, which can produce troughs and ridges and help to determine where our jets are located. So here you can see an upper air pressure map here showing you the airflow currents. Usually those upper air maps are made for a specific pressure surface. It's kind of a confusing idea, but basically they take an air pressure surface that's the same air pressure, and then they determine what the winds are like at that location. And your book has a great description of this as well. So these are the maps that can be produced from measuring pressure. You can also measure winds at the surface of the earth. We measure them using wind vanes, anemometers, aero vanes, objects like trees. And this is an example of an aero vane that shows you, it has a spinning part that can tell you the speed, and then it has this other vane part which tells you the direction. Wind direction is usually reported in the direction the wind is coming from, not going to. It's common confusion. And we measure in miles per hour, knots, or kilometers per hour. Once the wind speed is measured and direction is measured, we can construct a wind rose. These will show you a few different things. They can tell you the percent of the time the wind is blowing in a certain direction. So here you can see the majority of the time the wind was blowing to the north, with some smaller instances of maybe going to the east or southeast. And then this map here, you see for the majority of the time the wind was blowing to the south-southwest. And then you can determine the speed by looking at either the thickness of the line or the color as well. And that can help you determine how fast the winds are. So once we gather wind speed, pressure, temperature, all this information that we've learned so far, we construct what are called station models. And these station models show you a ton of information. So these station models have lots of information. There's some online media to help you discern what's what, and also there's an appendix in your textbook. So you can use feather that sticks out of the circle of station model to determine the speed of the wind and also the direction. And then we can also use the center circle to determine what the cloud cover is. And then these numbers all around it tell you air pressure tendency, temperature, and dew point. So if we look at A here, our air pressure, here we see 220. Well, what we need to do, they condense all this information onto a small area. So here, what you need to do is if your number here, if your first number is not zero, we're going to add a 9 to the front of this. So our air pressure here would be 922.0. So we add a 9 if your number, first number indicated on your station model is not zero, and then we add a decimal place. In station model B, our first number is a 0, so we're going to add 10. So our air pressure is going to be 1007.3. And then same thing with station model C, add a 10, and then we're going to have a pressure of 1009.5. Air temperature is as simple as that. We just read air temperature off. Here it's color-coded. Oftentimes it's not, so your air temperature is going to be the higher in the upper left corner. Your lower left corner is going to be your dew point temperature. So for station model A, our temperature is 81, dew point is 78. Cloud cover, use your textbook to help you discern what's what. Each of these symbols means something different. Up here, we have 7/8 cloud cover, B, we have scattered cloud cover, and C, it's obscured. Wind speed, we look at this vane to determine how many of these little feathers are sticking off the vane, and then the direction it's pointing is telling you the direction that the air is coming from. And then we see a pressure tendency, which is a symbol that is next to the numbers that are directly to the right. And this, these numbers tell you how much it's rising or falling, and you're going to have to add a decimal point to these as well. And all these rules are listed in that station model media. So at each of these stations, we produce one of these models, and there it can be plotted on one of these maps, and then we can use the air pressure to draw pressure lines, we can determine where fronts are, where lows are, and all that good stuff. And in the next few weeks, you guys are going to be using this information to determine where weather fronts are, where highs and lows are. So we will leave it at that and come back next week and move into storm systems and weather forecasting.